Brother Branham, and may the Lord bless you.
Thank you very much. Let us remain standing just a moment now as we bow for prayer. Let's bow our heads, and if there's any special request, would you just let it be known by your hands uplifted. Now hold in your heart those things that you need and ask the Heavenly Father that He'll grant. Our Heavenly Father, we are coming to Thee now in the name of the Lord Jesus. We are coming believing that the things that we desire is to be made known in prayer, and if we would believe that we receive what we ask for, it would be granted. That promise is so true. All these years we've seen it tested, and we know that it's true. We want to thank you first for sparing our lives and permitting us to be back here again together, assembled here in the congregation of the Lord. We thank thee for the church and for the pastor and for the great truth in which it's built here and stands for. We thank thee for every person that's in divine presence, and we ask that you'll be merciful to us today and grant unto us the understanding that we have need of, that we might be a more efficient servant for Thee. It's our heart's desire to serve Thee with reverence and with a true heart, and that You might get the very best out of our lives. Every day may our walks be so that You'll be well pleased with the things that we did for that day. Now we pray for all the sick and the needy today that's in the divine presence here and in the presence of your sanctuaries everywhere around the world, that the great Jehovah will come in His power and heal all the sick and afflicted. Get glory unto Thy great name. Bless every secret in the heart this morning of those requests for prayer. We pray now as you look down into every heart and see what they had reference to as they raised their hands, and give to them their desire. And bless us as we further worship you. And when we leave the building this morning and we go to our homes, may we be able to say like those who came from Emmaus, did not our hearts burn within us as He spoke to us along the way? We ask it in Jesus' name, amen. Be seated. I would like to say that it's good this morning to be here again in the congregation of the people in the presence of the Lord. It's been a few months since I was back, and last Sunday I intended to come down, but I suppose it wasn't the will of the Lord. Somehow the valley here is very unhealthy for me. As soon as I come into the valley, I'm allergic to this air that's in here. And I break out in hives all over. And I think the hives went right straight into the stomach. And I was so sick, I shivering and shaking and chills. And I just couldn't come down, although I got up and tried to force myself to do so. And I know that the valley is very unhealthy, and it's unhealthy, and I'm not supposed to live in it. Now, we want to report we have had a great time in the services of the Lord out across the different parts of the country where the Lord has called us to minister. And now, I wasn't expecting to speak this morning on any certain thing. If Brother Neville so wanted me to say something of being here with the people, so he's always gracious in that way, as we all know, Brother Neville, and we love Brother Neville, and there isn't a day that I don't think about him, and his wife, his family, his children, pray for them. God give him strength to go on, carry on. As we know, our time is running out. We're just so close of tomorrow. Amen. That's the evening lights of the day. And our families out in the West, we all got along fine and gained 12 pounds and lost 10 of it since I've been back. And Billy Paul gained 18 pounds, and Rebecca and Sarah and Joseph all gained. Of course, my wife didn't gain, so I'd be daring to say that up here, you know, because I have to go home after a while. But we had a wonderful time, and so grateful. We kind of bad, I thought, to come back, but it's one great thing, two things mainly that we missed, that there's no other place can take its place. One thing, our friends here and the church. No matter where we go, we find friends, and we're grateful for our friends, but there's something about those friends who stuck with you through the thick and thin that there's no way to substitute them friends. No matter what any other friend could be, there's no way to substitute a friend like that. You're just weaved into them. You're one. And we together looking for the coming of the Lord as the days go on. And it's kind of hard to try to think that you cannot be separated. It comes to my mind of a scripture that I believe Paul wrote and said in the Corinthians that there's nothing present, nothing future, and no powers, neither nakedness, starvation, peril, or any creature present, neither life nor death can separate us from the love of God that's in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
How that even death itself will never separate us, because we have been joined together in heart in this great fellowship around the Word of God, and even death itself will not separate us. We'll be united in the great eternals for all times and ages.
Amen.
And then the children. Of a morning, we would go to church, of course, but everywhere you go, it isn't the little tabernacle on the corner. And there's something about it. I miss hearing that little old bell and singing up there on top of a morning. And I think it isn't ringing at the time because they haven't put the steeple on just yet for the bell. And then together here at 8th and Penn Street, where some 35 years ago, kneeling here in an old swamp to build my first church, how the Lord Jesus dealt with me on that. And today it stands as a little shrine here, and as a brick mortar, it stands as a shrine, but down in the inside of my heart, it's a shrine that'll last as long as I have memory. And what makes the church is not the building, it's the people who gather beneath it to worship God. We're grateful for these things. And now, I thought maybe, being that our time was up almost and we don't have much time left, I would just kind of brief you on some things that's happened. And then I'm going to make some tapes while I'm here, because I promised you all, see, that any new message, tape message, would first be from this platform. Here's where all the tapes are made, not out there. Now, Brother Jim and them goes along and sells tapes in the meeting and so forth, but it's always on something that's come forth from here first. See, just check anywhere back, you'll find it. That's my promise to you. And it will continue that way until the Lord God changes it. And I think now that our tape customers, which around the world, a message that goes forth from here circles the globe. See, out into the jungles and everywhere it goes. By tape recordings and to the heathens and so forth. By many, many different languages it's interpreted in. So I want, while I'm here, the Lord willing, to make some new tapes. And maybe, if the pastor hasn't got something burning for his heart tonight, well, I'd like to maybe make a tape tonight. And then I'm going to Arkansas tomorrow, Tuesday morning, to help out in a little convention there with the International Brotherhood of Christians. I think, or maybe I mispronounced that. It's something about National Brotherhood of Christians. I really don't know. I'm sorry. That's awful, isn't it? Thank you, sir. Associated Brotherhood of Christians. And I was supposed to have from Sunday now on through, but I helped today for the tabernacle to be down here. And then then I'll get out on Friday. Is that, sir? Friday's when the meetings close down there. And I'll try to get back Saturday night to be here Sunday morning, the Lord willing. I'll make another tape.
Amen.
And maybe sometimes along down I want to make a few tapes before we go. And then I'm really pressing for Baton Rouge, Louisiana to that convention. And then come back, and then I'm supposed to go by all means to Anchorage, see, and from Fairbanks and Lang, Anchorage for the Christian Full Gospel Businessman on those chapters. And then back, and if the Lord willing, up to Chicago at the last week in July. And I suppose then about that time I'll have to hurry the children off to Arizona again to be in, get them in school out there, because Charlie, I have to be here about the 15th of August, so I want to be back by that time, the Lord willing, down in Kentucky. Everybody laughing. Maybe some of the newcomers wouldn't know what that meant. And it's kind of, I hope it don't sound bad from the platform, but that's when squirrel season comes in. Mama gosh, I'm depending on that this evening. So, for a couple weeks down there for my vacation. Now, I believe I got something here that Billy wrote me some little notes, and one of them said, Daddy, Brother Neville wants to know if you could dedicate two children.
Yes.
Certainly. That'd be fine. And, yes, we have a dedicational service at the... We might as well have that now. And then I think we'll kind of take the next 45 minutes or something on breathing on some of the things that's taking place. Now, many of the people and churches, being that this is an open tabernacle. It's never been a denomination. God grant that it won't, never. Because we want this a place where we have no law but love. No creed but Christ. No textbooks but the Bible. And then we do not have membership, we have fellowship one with another for all people, all denominations. Everybody's welcome. And we have fellowship around the Word of God where everybody can feel welcome as they can be. In principle, we just love the Lord Jesus, and we're not a scholarly group here. We're just plain people that try to just read the Bible and put no interpretation to it outside of what it just says. Just, I believe that God will judge the world someday by the Bible.
Amen.
Now, if he's going to judge the world, and if there isn't a standard to judge by, how will the people know what to do? See, it would be God. You could not pin injustice to God. And God's got to have something for His standard that He judges the people by. Therefore, if He judges it by the Roman Catholic Church, then the Greek Church, the Orthodox Catholic, and many of those are certainly lost, and all the rest of the world. If He judges it by the Greek Orthodox Catholic Church and not by the Roman Church and the other, then the Roman Church and all the rest is lost. If He judges it by the Lutheran Church, then the Presbyterians is gone. If He judges it by the Presbyterians, the Lutheran and Baptist is gone, see? So if He judges it by the Pentecostals, then all besides Pentecostals is gone. But He'll not judge it by any church, in my opinion, because there's too much differences and too much confusion. But He'll judge it, the Bible says, He'll judge the world by Jesus Christ. Now,
amen.
That's scriptural.
Amen.
Now, and the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Hallelujah.
So He is the Word. And this is Christ in letter form. And in the book of Apocalypse to the Catholic, Revelation to the Protestant, and the 22nd chapter, when the book was finished, Jesus said himself, if any man will take one word from this book or add one word to it, the same his part will be taken from the book of life.
Amen.
So the reason we believe this is to say just exactly nothing. He can do things that he hasn't written here. We know that. But as long as we just stay with what he has wrote, that'll be fine. Amen. Now, in dedication of children, many of the people, the Methodists sprinkle them, and I think they had their first communion in the Catholic Church, or Lutheran, along about 12 years old, and kind of a baptismal service when they're born. I think the babies are sprinkled, and I think that splits the Nazarene from the Methodist many years ago on infant baptism. I think that's right, Brother Brown. I believe that that was what split the Methodist Church and the Nazarene, because the Nazarene didn't accept infant baptism. But to us, here at the tabernacle, if we're going to stay with what the Bible says, there's no place in the Bible where they ever did sprinkle anybody, let alone a baby, not even an adult. But the Bible says, the only place that our Bible for the children, they brought infants to Jesus, and that he might put his hands upon them and bless them. And he said, suffer, little children, to come to me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. Now, therefore, we know that we are poor hands, the pastor and I or any other pastor, to take the hands of the Lord Jesus. And if he was here this morning, these parents would bring that baby to Christ. But being that we are here in representation of him, that we represent him, they bring the children to us, and we dedicate them to the Lord by laying our hands up on him in commemoration of his great word and his act. So that's how we dedicate the little ones. I thought maybe some mother might be here with her baby that's never been dedicated to the Lord, that she might want to come along with these mothers or fathers who will be dedicating their children. We just bring them up here and present them to God and pray over them and tell the Lord that we lay our hands up on them and a substitute way for his. And that's as close to the scripture as I've ever found yet. Now, you might get your textbook out and find something that some group of man said, but I mean what the Word says, you see. Now, I think I've made it real, real clear what it is. Now, if the pianist, or you the pianist, will come up here. Is that awful in my own church? Ask, who's the pianist? I almost have to knock at the door. All right. They sing this little song or play it, bring them in, bring them in, bring the little ones to Jesus. And while the congregation sings this, let's stand to our feet and let the mothers and fathers that bring their little ones come down and sing. All right.
Bring them in.
Now, Pastor, now we have a little fellow here who's sleeping, and sometimes they amen a little loud, so we understand that they're babies. What is your name, sir? William Henry Vincent. And your little girl? Christina Maria Vincent. What a lovely little fellow laying on the shoulder of her father. May I have her? Christina, I can't substitute for your father here. You lay your hands upon me. Let us bow our heads. Our Heavenly Father, we are approaching thy throne today up beyond our faith, lift us beyond the moon, stars, beyond the solar system, into the presence of the Almighty. We bring this lovely little child. We know not what we hold in our arms, Lord. It might be a great servant to you in the days to come. We trust that it's so. But the father of the child has brought the little one to us that we might lay our hands upon it, that we have confessed to be your servants, to act in your place until you return, and then you take over all things. Until then, Lord, we're to serve you with trueness and sincerity, and with our hands laid upon this little girl, we bless her in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Trust that you'll give her a long life of Jesus' heritage and may she become a great servant to you. Bless the home that she'll be raised in. May she be brought up in the admonition of God and serve him all the days of her life. Bless her parents, and may they live to see this child an honorable vessel unto the Lord because of their acts today. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. God bless you. God bless you, sir. Her name is Sister Cadette, Teresa. I just don't know whether we're going to be able to hold Teresa or not. I don't think so. She knows a little more. Well, let us bow our heads. Our Heavenly Father, as we lay our hands upon the sister of this little one just dedicated to you, the parents want this little one dedicated also. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ rest upon this child and give her a long life, a blessed life, a service to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Bless you, mommy. Bless you all. You're my fortunate parents this morning to have those two lovely little fellows. His name? Joe William Carton. He's taking his siesta this morning. All right. Now, if you all will, you can go to your seat if you will, and then let little Joseph come up here. All right. And you can hold him if you wish to. Our Heavenly Father, we bring to you this little Joseph William Cartwright. The Father stands this morning to give back to you that which you've given to him in a life of service. God bless the little one, and may he live a long life, healthy, strong, and become a great servant to you. Bless his father and mother in the home that he'll be raised in. May Christ be that unseen guest at all times. And we give this little boy to you for a life of service in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Bless you. Let it be. Little girl. Amen. Sylvia Shipley. Our Heavenly Father, we are laying our hands upon this little girl as a loved one brings her here this morning, standing at the altar. May the blessings that would come upon her if the Lord Jesus laid his own nail-scarred hands upon this child. May them blessings rest upon the little one. Bless her now, and may she live a long, happy life and be a servant to you. Bless her home, her parents, her loved ones. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do this task according to the Bible. Amen. We can go to be a singer. What's the name? Laura Ellen. I said he's going to be a singer. It reminds me, I hope this doesn't sound bad at the church, but one day I was talking to an Indian, had a little baby standing there, and I kept saying, he's a nice fella, and he's a nice fella. And the chief watched me a few minutes and he looked down and said, but him or her? I guess that's about the way it is. Lori. Lori Allen. Allen is her last name. John. Lori Allen. Lori Allen. She's a beautiful little thing. Our Heavenly Father, as we lay our hands upon this little child. And in the Bible, they said they brought little infants to you, and you laid your hands upon them and blessed them. And that's the act that we perform in commemoration of your great act on earth. Bless this child, its parents, May the home be a constant place of prayer, faith, and may the little girl live a long, happy life and be your servant all those days. And may the family never be wheel broken. In glory, may every member be assembled around the great throne of God of that day to go to live forever. Until then, Lord, may your eternal blessing rest upon the child and be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. That her little sister, Rebecca. Heavenly Father, we lay our hands upon little Rebecca and bless her also in the name of the Lord Jesus. Just as though she was going to the water, to the pool. And I trust, Lord, that the day will come when she becomes the age of accountability, that she will make her stand and walk right down to the pool there and be baptized for the remission of her sins. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Right. Now bless her with her little sister, and she live a long, happy life. His turn of Jesus. Amen. Little Jacqueline Kennard, another pretty little girl. Now, Heavenly Father, we lay our hands upon the little girl in commemoration of the great Lord Jesus who laid his hands upon him with his blessings. And may the blessing come upon the child as though your own hand was upon it today. If you were here on earth in a physical body, the mother would bring the child to you. But as we as your representatives, she comes the second grandfather, and we ask that you will bless the child who we bless. In the name of Jesus Christ, may it live a long, happy life and be your servant. Bless it. Home it'll be raised in. May it be a constant house of prayer. In Jesus' name. All right, now this little boy is James Davis. I thought I knew your sister. You and your missionary, you and your husband. Is your hubby with you this morning? Well, Lord, bless those of you. And you sure have some fine, nice little children. This is David and this
James Davis.
I was just speaking with a sister from Florida who was studying this morning. This little boy, when he was from Florida, while he was there, a little boy, just a lad, little bitty, tiny fellow, went into the backyard and was looking up at the plane that he saw. Now, the little David. Noon, we lay our hands upon him in dedication of a life to service to Jesus Christ. Continue your blessings upon his home, Lord, and make his father and mother, Lord, to be strong and healthy and carry on the work that you have called them to do as missionaries. And now lay a little David in a long, happy life of service to Jesus Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name. And to his little brother Joseph, Lord God, yet a lad, and looked into the sky and saw the power of the Lord Jesus. May the blessings of God come upon this little boy who we dedicate for service to Jesus Christ this morning. And may your great Holy Spirit lead this child, Lord, maybe somewhere in my spirit. There is a tomorrow. You continue on with the gospel. And we so gallantly try to stand for the day. Bless you, Father. Be blessed in your name. Amen. Bless you. God bless you, Father. Jesus standing under the tree. Well, I ought to know this young man. Yes, sir. How do you do? I can't think of his name. Danny Eugene Pauling. Well, I hope you follow the footsteps of Dad, mature little boy. And this little boy, this people come to the tabernacle constantly. And first time I've seen him since he was, I guess, first time I've ever seen him before. Yes, it is the first time I've ever seen him. Heavenly Father, we bring to you a little baby this morning that's been placed in the care of this Christian home under the tutorship of a this Christian father and mother.
Hallelujah.
We're grateful to see little ones born in such a home, Lord, because we believe that they'll be raised in the admonition of God.
Amen.
I lay my hands upon him with the pastor in the name of Jesus
Amen.
Christ. May the baby live and be strong and healthy and be a servant to you all the days of his life. This we ask in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Lord bless his family. That was through prayer that he arrived to. That's very fine. Robert Douglas Samples, another pretty little blue-eyed boy. Heavenly Father, we bring to you this little blue-eyed boy this morning as he stands on the altar where souls have been born over for the last 30 years. May you receive him, Lord, this morning as we lay our hands upon him and dedicate him to the kingdom of God and to service and to a life of health and strength. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do this. Amen. Bless you, little fella. I didn't know, Jenny, when you stand there, my hand ain't been in. Your little family's growing. Very fine. Now, what's it, Sean Patrick Cooper? The little boy's grandfather and I have been lifelong friends, just little boys and students. He wasn't very much bigger than this when we met. Let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, maybe about 40 years ago, standing in the school door up here on the Utica Pikes, did I ever know that that little boy, we bashful looking across each other, that someday I'd lay my hand upon his grandfather, dedicated to the Lord God. Receive little Sean this morning, Lord, as a servant to you. The mother and father gallantly praying to give back to God what's been given to their care. And may they live a strong life of health and strength and determination in Christ. Now we give you this little boy in the name of Jesus Christ as a life of service. May we live on and serve you.
Amen.
This little girl, what's her name? Likewise, upon a little Carl, we lay our hands this morning and dedicate her to the service of Jesus Christ. God bless her. May she live a long, happy life. May she be a servant to you all the days of this life. Grant her, Lord. Bless her home. Let it always be a place of prayer and faith. I give you this lovely little girl this morning from the heart of the father and mother. Stand on the little altar in the name of Jesus Christ. Our Heavenly Father, the Father of these little ones holds now in his arms the last little treasure that you've given in the form of a child, named his son his father, Jesus. God grant that he'll be a man of wisdom like James is in the Bible. I pray that you'll give him a long, healthy life, Lord, and may he raise up as there is a tomorrow and let him catch the word of God. Grant it, Father. In memoration of what Jesus Christ our Lord did when he was on earth, I lay my hands up on through James' school and dedicate him to the service of God. Lord God, upon the head of this little boy, Jerry Dean Allen, may the blessings of Jesus Christ rest. As we lay our hands upon him, as we dedicate this young life to you, bless his home, his parents, may he live a long, happy life of service to our God and his God, who we give him to you now, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I think that's about about does this now. Now we're just exactly on time at 11 o'clock. You know, I can just imagine seeing those mothers coming along, and daddies with those babies. I could think of Joseph and Mary the morning of the dedication of the Lord Jesus. Brother Kidd, I was having a little interview with someone in the office, but I heard your emotion this morning out here of a man of your age, and I suppose you were telling of how the Lord healed you. The audience almost tore my car up one morning to get to the elderly. He's an old minister. Just think, this man was, his little wife here was preaching the gospel before I was born. Preaching this gospel up over the mountains and valleys of Kentucky and Tennessee with coal miners and being run out and live without anything to eat. And this little wife here washed on a washboard for about 20 or 30 cents a day to send her husband into the field to preach the gospel. That's enough to make a person excited, isn't it? And then to think that there he laid when the very best of doctors said he's dying, is prostrate, cancer all through him, he can't live but just a number of hours, and mainly a day or two. And that's been two or three years ago, 3 years ago, and here he is this morning, healthy, well, giving God glory. Then, how old were you when you were healed, Brother Kidd? About what was the age when God... How old is he now?
He's 82.
80?
83 in
August. All right, and he was about 80 years old when God healed. Now, does God care for us old people? Sure he does. Yes, sir. He healed Abraham when he was 100 years old, and Sarah when she was 90. And they brought forth Ishmael, or beg your pardon, Isaac.
Yeah.
Is that right? We're very happy for this. Now, you're so nice, I could talk to you all morning just like this, but let's just read some of the precious words and then go right into the service. Now, I think if it be the will of God, I would like to kind of brief you on things that happened. And then tonight, if the Lord willing, I want to speak on a subject. I want to tape it mainly to go out. If you want to come listen, all right. After the pastor gets through his message, then I'll have my. I'll make this tape. I want to preach it on the flashing red light of his coming.
Wow!
One of the flashes is right on us right now, and I want to speak on that tonight. The flashing red light. He's here, being right on the hand right now. Signal's down.
Amen.
The train's in the block. Numbers 16th chapter to you who will turn and read. This is the eternal word, so let's read reverently. I want to read two verses of Numbers 16, the third and fourth verse, to get a little background on what I wish to say. And now, if the tapes are not on, I wish they would turn them on now or fix it so that this part here will be able to be sent out. This is going out of the order. Can you fix your tapes in there to where this part here will be separate from the rest of the service? See, this is a new thing. Now, if you can block it right here or whatever you do, well, then we'll... would you like them in a... snap it off just a second and turn it back on so he give you a block to know where to start from, or can you start there anyhow? Start anyhow. All right, that's fine. Now, we're going to read Numbers 16, 3 and 4. And they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron, and said unto them, ye take too much upon you, seeing all the congregations are holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Wherefore then lift ye up yourselves above the congregation of the Lord. And when Moses heard it, he fell upon his face. Our Heavenly Father, bless these few words, and may the meditation of our heart and the fruits of our lips be acceptable in thy sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I want to take this as a text for what I wish to say this morning. Standing in the gap. This time that we're speaking of, or reading, of course we all understand that it was when Dathan and Korah had decided that they would interfere with the commission that God had given to Moses, saying, you ought to let the whole congregation do such and such. They're all holy. And God had commanded Moses to lead the people to the promised land. And they said, you take it upon yourself to do too much. You try to make yourself the only one in the bunch that's got any say-so. And this pleased God so much until he told Moses, separate yourself from among them. I'll just kill the whole bunch and start a new generation with you. And Moses fell in the presence of God and said, it had to come over him. See? Now, today, if God was going to liquidate the people, and there was a time that when God had got tired of fooling with our sin, we constantly going wrong, who would stand like Moses today for the people? Where would we find a person that would stand or could stand, that God would accept like he did Moses? And Moses' own life on earth meant so much to God till it stayed the wrath of God. And God would not cross over Moses. That always was a puzzle to me till I, one day in revelation of the Scripture, there came this thought to me that, you see, Moses in act was every way substituting. He was a type of Jesus Christ. And when God was going to take the life of the whole world and destroy it, and all was sinners and condemned to die, Christ died for us all. And God could not cross over Christ, being his own son, and then Jesus gave himself freely that he might pay the way then, if Moses couldn't have done that. Moses had no blood but human blood like we are. So therefore his blood would not be, it would not suffice. But Jesus, being the blood of God himself, the created blood of God, God just excused the entire human race then of sin, because it's all laid upon him. And he went to Calvary and died out of the presence of God and suffered and was cast into hell, because that he was sin, made our sins upon him, and there being our burden barrier, took our sins to Calvary, and from Calvary to hell, and God raised him up on the third day for a propitiation of our sins, and today he's the only mediator between God and man, and we're freely pardoned and forgiven. God don't even know we ever sinned. Our sins were put in the sea of forgiveness, never be remembered no more. We cannot do that ourselves. We're finite. He's infinite. And our finite, we can still remember because we're not big enough. But he's so great that he even forgets we ever did sin. We're sons and daughters in his presence. And all things that he was, we are. He become my sin, that I might become his righteousness.
Amen.
He become your sin, that you might become his righteousness. So God cannot see no sin in you as long as your confession is in Christ Jesus. Someone said some time ago, said, if I believed a thing like that, would I ever turn on the steam? I'd paint the town red. I'd go to every dance hall. I'd get so drunk and everything, because, why, you're already secured in Christ. What difference does it make? I said, that shows you haven't got it.
Amen.
If the love of God ever struck your heart and the tenderness of Jesus Christ, you'd be so in love with Him, the world would be dead as your sin. That's how you know you have the Holy Spirit. Not because that you can scream, shout, speak or tongues or whatever it is, but when sin becomes dead and you're alive in Jesus Christ. Oh, love of God, how rich, how pure.
Amen.
Now, here in Louisville, Kentucky, not long ago, a minister was talking that there was a young lady, she'd waited a little long in life to be married, somewhere around her 25, 30 years old, and she was a fine, staunch Christian girl. And there was a certain man in Louisville that wasn't, he hadn't lived such a good life. He had run the dances and roadhouses and so forth, but one day he found pardon for his sin. And he became a real Christian, real staunch Christian. About a year later, he fell in love with this young lady, and the young lady madly fell in love with him. And they were married. After they lived together about 2 years, it said that this young lady said to her husband one day, she said, "Dear, I suppose that's kind of hard for you, just a new Christian." Said, "I've been a Christian since a little girl." But said, "For you, a young Christian, to have to stand all the wiles and temptations that goes with it after you in sin so long." And he said, "Well, it does become a battle." She said, "I want you to remember one thing, that if the enemy does upset you somewhere, and you fall, and you go back into sin, don't stay away from home. I want you to come on home." Said, "You're going to find at home the same wife that you married." And said, "I'll help you to pray back and pray through and get back to God again." Said, I don't want you to stay away. Said, "Look, I married you upon the basis not of what you were, but I married you because I loved you." And she said, "No matter what you do, I still love you. I married you because I loved you." And the man that day went to work, was heard repeating it in the place where he was working. He said, "Now how could a man do anything wrong against something like that? When a woman that loves him so much, and no matter what he did, was willing to come back and take him again and try it again." See, it shows, now you multiply that by billions, and then you have some idea of what the love of God is. See? That when a man falls in love with Jesus Christ, the things of the world, when you think of what he did for you in the light of the Scripture, not in the light of some emotion, but in the light of facts, what it is. Then there's something happens in you when the new birth comes to sin is dead as midnight. When as long as that light is in you, how can darkness shine? It cannot do it. That's what God did to one man who sowed himself in the gap that could take the promise. And Moses being a type of this antitype, that's why Moses stood in the gap for the people. Then I wonder, in this day of this loose, lazy, soft, Laodicea age that we live in, we all know and have been through the church ages, that we're living in the last age, the Laodicea church age. And in this lazy, loose, happy-go-lucky, joking, sinful age of lust that we're living in now, it's a wonder that God doesn't just step back, church. I'll just liquidate the whole group, see? What an age that we're living in, and He will do that one of these days, too. We know that it's coming. There isn't going to be no sparing to this, because He's already, someone died for those who wanted to escape, but He'll take those who was or has accepted Christ and become Christians, they'll be taken out of the wrath, because then He could not do it. There was no way of doing it in the time of Moses. Now, in the book of the Revelation, when we get to the Laodicea church age, in the Revelation, the third chapter, the Bible said that this age, the Laodicea age, was blind. said, because you are rich, you say you're rich, and you're increased in goods, greatest churches, the finest dressed people, the greatest that there's been in any age, because you say, I have need of nothing, knowest thou not that thou art poor, miserable, wretched, naked, blind, and don't know it. Now, if a man was in this condition and you could tell him his condition, he'd try to help himself if he is mentally right. But when he's in that condition and you can't tell him any different, he just don't believe it, he's naked. He doesn't believe that he's in that shape. Then it shows you that he's blind. The God of this world has blinded the eyes of those that refuse to serve Christ. And they're so blind they can't see the sign that we're living in. The hour, the time that we are living in. And remember, there's already been one standing the gap, and no one else can stand. You either have to accept that remedy or you're doomed. Now to us, to get close now to what I want to say. Could we stand? Now I'm preaching to myself in this. Could we stand and see a human being that's blind, physically blind, and know that he's walking over a cliff? Could we, in our state of mind that we're in this morning, could we stand and see a blind man walk over a cliff blind and not try to warn him? There would be so cruel. We would be so indifferent in our hearts. Could you imagine a person getting so indifferent that he could almost laugh and see a blind man cannot see and can't help himself deliberately walk over a cliff? That would be a bad thing. Do nothing about it. Well, to my brethren world over, I want to make this confession. I humbly say it, that's just about what I was doing, or fixing to do. I had been preaching for years. And I become an old man, and an old veteran preacher. I had a lot of hard battles. Scarred, all cut up on the inside from fights, because my lot that the Lord gave me was not back to kiss the babies and marry the young and bury the old, but it was to hold a two-handed sword at the battlefront against the wiles of paganism and demonology and the powers of darkness, and fight it with the Word of God till I've seen the enemy defeated. I've been cut deep many times. Then when I come with a message in this day and have said to the church the things that I am about to say, and I predicted years ago when the Holy Spirit called me to this work, and there isn't a person living on earth today that could ever say that the Lord ever let me tell you anything in His name but what come to pass. Amen. Just exactly the way it was to be done. How that He sent me out first, and the first gift and the second gifts and the things that's been said or done the world over, and literally millions have come to Christ, and tens of thousands of preachers inspired that start a revival that sweeps the entire face of the earth today. And being that the Pentecostals was the one received my message, they're the one that gained ground. The Pentecostal church shows more conversions in the little group of Pentecostals than all the rest of the churches put together. That's statistics. Why? because of them receiving truth and receiving the revival. And now, after the great time come of the healing of the sick, the casting out of devils, and the raising up of the dead, which we're all witnesses, and so is many doctors and great men of the earth, and the appearing of the Lord Jesus among us as in the sign there, as you see, I guess, on the wall, wherever it is, of the angel of the Lord, and how the scientists have copyrighted it, and it's a known fact the world over, and see the very things that he did come to pass every time. Then if the pillar of fire that went with Israel across the wilderness in the days of Moses that we are now, that Moses was called the servant of the Lord, and he followed a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. And when Jesus was on earth, he said that he was that God. He said, before Abraham was, I am. And I am was the pillar of fire that was in the burning bush that spoke to Moses in the days gone by. I think that's correct, Brother Barry. Then he said, I come from God and I go to God. And when he was crucified, died, and rose and ascended on high and laid his body down upon the great altar of the eternal God, to there ever be present to act in our place, to know that he had paid our sin debt. And there he returned back to the earth again in the form of a great pillar of fire. St. Paul, on his road before he was called St. Paul, he was called Saul of Tarsus. And on his road down to Damascus to arrest some people who were making too much noise and shouting and preaching a gospel that was contrary to the tradition of the churches, on his road down one day about this time in the day, he was stricken down by a great light. And this great light, him being a Jew and know that the pillar of fire had led the children of Israel, and here it was before him again, he cried out, Lord. Now, if you notice in your translations on both King James and the Standard and all, it's capital L-O-R-D. And anyone who knows their Bible knows that when that's capital L-O-R-D is Elohim. Amen. The all-sufficient one that created the heavens and earth in Genesis 1:1. Lord. Now, Paul would have not called some optical illusion. He wouldn't have called something they didn't know about, because he was a trained man in the Scriptures, come up under Gamaliel, the great teacher of that day, and he would not have called that Lord if he wasn't satisfied that that was Jehovah. Amen. He said, Lord, who are you? And listen to the voice come back, I'm Jesus. The same yesterday, today, and forever. So I think in the midst of all of it, before going any farther, both here and across the world, the people who will be listening, and listening now, will know that it is proven by every act to be Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
Done the very same things that he did. Healed the sick, know the thoughts of the mind, showed forth things that would come to pass, and every time perfectly through these years. I'm 54 years old and saw vision since I was about 18 months old, and not one time, but every time it's been the truth.
Amen.
Now, that has to be God. Amen. And then me thinking that, why are the people so blind that they can't see that? And constantly when I talk to our women about bobbing their hair, and the ministers bawling me out about it, and about them wearing immoral clothes, these shorts, and laying out like that, and carrying on of that evil way, and about our man, the way they were doing, smoking and taking sociable drinks and everything, and then still calling themselves Christians and taking communion at the table, because if they belonged to an organization, oh, it was just simply they thought I blasphemed God. And did the women get better? They got worse across the nation. Then being a nervous, I say this kind of quietly, maybe a neurotically type of person that I am, and knowing that I was insufficient at the beginning for the job, as many has complained that had it to do, it was hard. But I thought, God, why didn't you call somebody that could have done it? Now, I'm sorry, but I failed. The people just won't listen to me. And I failed to do what I should have done somewhere because they won't listen. My mother, that's just passed on into glory about a little over a year ago, my mother, her father was a hunter. And I think I got all to come out from him in that stand called I love the woods. And I thought, if this people that call themselves Christians, if they don't want to listen to the message that I'm preaching, then let them alone. I'll just stop it altogether. And I'll go up into the mountains. And I'll know a friend of where many of you here remember me predicting the time about 6 months before it happened, how that I would go to a place right from this platform here, and there would be an animal that looked like a deer with pointed horns, and how it would be 42 inches, and how there would be a 7-foot silver-tipped grizzly. You got it on tapes and everything. I get that. You remember the time, all of it. Well, it's laying in my room up there now to show that's the truth. Now, just on things like that, because it's just before the going of my mother, and he is wanting to quiet me for that great shock that he knew he was to take her. Now, I met a man who was a Christian, and he's got a great country right under Alaska. And I had made up in my mind that then I'd left here and gone west, that I would take my wife and kind of trap her into something. I'd get her up there and I'd become a guide. And then if the Lord wanted me to do something, I'd let my hair grow out and my whiskers, and I'd go back in there and be a guide. There's only about 2 or 3 Indians live back in the country there, and I'd just be a guide. And I'd help Bud, and if the Lord wanted me to do anything, then I'd say, all right, Lord, he'd give me a vision. I'd slip on out. I said to people, I've never regarded myself, anybody knowing this, but people have said, Brother Branham, the Lord called you to be his prophet. Well, I've never regarded myself as that, but I begin to get to the time that I was about ready to do it. To think, well, maybe I am. If I am, I'll live back in the wilderness. And if I live back in the wilderness, then I'll be his prophet. See, and then if he wants to send me somewhere, and while he's not using me, then I'll sure catch some fine fish and do some things. Of course, that was kind of a selfish attitude, see, because I wanted to do that. Now, it isn't just exactly the thing that to do. Now, I had that made up in my mind to do that. And now, just before the 7 church ages is preached, as they're drawn there, there's many today that was here during that time and know that how the Lord did bless that on the wall back there. It reflected it. So how many sure now that was there then when he came? That did it. Then I remember then of a brother Jackson. He's usually with us. Brother Junior Jackson, the Methodist, was a Methodist minister. Yeah, here he is sitting over here now. Now, that he come to me with a dream. And then some more brethren come with similar dreams. Now the Lord's been real good to me. And I have never, and take you to record this morning, have I ever told you a wrong interpretation of a dream. No, sir, because of the Lord, I will not speak it till I see it over again and know what he says about it, and then I'll tell you. And then he said, I was having a service down to his church. And he, somehow or another, he was real nervous that night, and he ran out of the church and come around the other way and met me in the car, and the people passing by said, I want to tell you something. And he told me that he dreamed a dream that up here somewhere like in Indiana, that there was a long, great grassy hill, and the water washed all the soil off the top, it become rock, like a ball top on the mountain. And then in this rock, there was funny writing. And said I was standing there with all the brethren around the church here interpreting this writing. And then when it come to time that I got all of it interpreted, then that I somehow or another, if I understand the dream right, got a hold of something like a crowbar or some kind of an angle bar or something, or not an angle bar, I meant a pry bar or something, and just cut the top of that mountain out and lifted it up. And on the inside of it was white rock, something on the order of granite or something on that side, some white rock that wasn't written on. And I said to the brethren, stay here looking on this. And I, while they were all looking, I slipped out from among them and started going west. And Brother Jackson said that he saw me going over one hill and then another hill, getting smaller and smaller, going west. You remember that? Well, the interpretation of that, of course, was given here at the church before it come to pass, that the time is now that I believe that the full revelation through the age of Luther, Wesley, and John Smith, Alexander Campbell, and different ones that preached on the Bible, and then we got over in the Bible and showed that there would be a seventh angel's message. And at the sounding of the seventh angel's message, all the mysteries of God would be made known. Then comes seven mysterious thunders. And now, if it is that end, age that we're living in, where we've come up to justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Spirit, and had signs, wonders, and all different things, and the gift has returned to the church, such as divine healing and prophecy and speaking with tongues and interpretations, and though it's been misrepresented terrifically, but yet that don't take away there's a good one, there's a true one, a real, genuine gift of speaking in tongues that's always supposed to be in the church. We have a lot of impersonations. We have people get up and try to act like Christians, and their lives don't compare, so there's something wrong. Jesus said, by their fruit you'll know them. That's how you know a Christian, by how he lives. Don't ever jump any higher than you live. So then but in that, it's a devil making a scarecrow to keep the real genuine believers away from the true thing of it. But God help us to separate and be able to discern between right and wrong. And the Word will always straighten that out. Now we find that in this, I told you that the interpretation on the rock, and the rock is Christ, that was in the brother's dream. And that's the Bible. And for all these years, the Bible's been interpreted till we've absolutely given it the ecclesiastical interpretation through. And the last gift being added in the Laodicean Age, which is the seventh angel's time to preach in the Laodicean Age, at that time, that's there would be a lot of things that was misconstrued down through the ages. Like Luther preached justification, but he let it run wild because he didn't live long enough. And along, then he organized the church. Luther never organized it. After Luther. And then Wesley come forth, and after Wesley, they got the Wesleyan church. And then after that come John Smith the Baptist, and then Alexander Campbell, and so forth. But the man, the reformers, didn't live long enough to get it all together. And so there's a lot of loose ends left, like. And then when they did, for instance, the water baptism that John Smith brought back, the water baptism and immersing, but using the title, and many of those things that was left loose. And then when we come down to the end, the last message is supposed to straighten that all up, to bring these things to one faith, one Lord, one baptism. And now, after the Bible had been interpreted completely, then you notice it opened up the top of the pyramid, like rock. Not pyramid teaching now, not that, because the man who teaches that pyramid doctrine, I guess they know what they're talking about, I know nothing about it. But however, it was in the shape of a pyramid. But the cap on the pyramid was never put on. I've been in Cairo and in Egypt, and the cap never did come because it was a cornerstone. It was a headstone. In the church, it was the cornerstone. In the full church, it was a headstone. So it never did come. It was rejected, Christ. And it will come. And I believe that when it's coming, that the church will shape into a place from justification under Luther, sanctification under Wesley, and the Pentecostal message will bring the church to such a minority, and a ministry will be among those people who will be exactly the same ministry that Jesus Christ did, that will bring Jesus and catch the whole thing away. All those honest and true Lutherans, Presbyterians, Baptists, Methodists, and whoever's born to the Spirit of God will be caught away with Jesus Christ when He comes. I believe that. I differ with some of our Pentecostal brethren who believe that the remnant of the church is those who will be caught away in this last age. I differ there because God, how could a man, how could God, if we would say, how could He can do what He wishes to, but God who promised Luther and other justification, that's all they know. See? He promised to take the church. And I can believe by the grace of God and by the Scriptures support it, because He didn't come in the first watch and they went to sleep in the second watch, on down. In the seventh watch He comes. And that's the seventh church age, that's the seventh angel's message. And when He comes, all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. Presbyterian, Lutheran, Baptist, whoever that's born of the Spirit of God shall go in that rapture. I believe that the bride will be called out during that time. I believe there will be some in the last days who won't have to taste death, but will be changed in a moment, a twinkling of an eye. Now, but insomuch as you notice in Brother Jackson's dream that there was no writing on this rock on the inside, that's what I went west for. Now, as it's happened, now I told you someday I would tell you what it meant. I went west for it. And told you the vision, which the people both on tape and present this morning will know and take and serve. What time is it? And any of you tape brethren that doesn't have that message, you want to follow this, take serve. What time is it? Before, weeks and months before it happened, here I saw the vision of being at Tucson, north of Tucson, that'd be east of Flagstaff, north of Tucson, and would be picking birds off of my trouser legs, and a blast would go off that would actually look like shake the country. How many of you remember that?
Sure.
That would shake the country. Well, it happens to be that at least one man is present this morning who was standing there when it happened. It actually shook the rocks off of the mountain. And now they... we find out that during that time I saw seven angels in a form of a pyramid that swept down and picked me up, and I was brought east to open the seven seals for God. If you haven't got them, if Jesus tarries, and I, my great-grandchildren, little Paul's children, that will still be the eternal truth of the living God. Now, that was to find out that was sealed inside this mountain. That wasn't rope. It had to be interpreted, and when I come back, the first angel on the first night opened the seal contrary to anything we ever heard in our lives. And all seven come out the same way.
Amen.
You know that. Amen. You were here present when it happened, many of you. And now, I didn't know it at that time, but Brother Fred Stockman, I know he's here, and I'm pretty sure Brother Norman is here. If we was up, I had to go to Houston about getting that little boy saved from the electric chair. And then I went back, and I went hunting up there with the brethren, and that morning I was standing there picking cuckleburrs, or what they call goat heads there, birds off of my trouser legs, and the blast did just exactly the way it said it. Is that right, Brother Fred? And I must have jumped way off of the ground, and just above me was the angels of the Lord, that sent message back for me, come here to break these seals. Why here? Why at the tabernacle? Why did I do it there? Because I'd made a promise to my church and to God that any new message would come from this tabernacle, recorded from here. And he was helping me to keep my word, to stay back here to do it. And then immediately I went back again. And now I didn't know at the time that they were taking pictures of that. Scientists was, as the angels lowered themselves from heaven to bring the message. And you remember I said the one on the right side of the constellation had his, kind of his chest back and his wings. You remember me saying that, all of you?
Yeah.
And how that I watched him, he is very distinctive from the others. And I didn't know they were taking a picture of it, because immediately I hurried east. But going back home to Tucson, there was all through the papers that had been seen almost nationwide, or from into Mexico, all the western states, and I think the Courier over here, he was on the Associated Press. How many saw mysterious clouds in the sky and see the hand? And now the Life magazine picked it up. And I have the article here this morning in the Life magazine to show. Now here it is. The same time I was there, see the pyramid of the cloud? I was standing just below this. And there, see the distinctive angel on the right-hand side? See the pointed wing of it? This is exactly what was said. And here's interviews from Mexico and different places from where they took the picture. Now, this scientist here is trying to get all the information about the picture that he can about the people who has the picture. He's studying it. Now he says here that it would be impossible for it to be a cloud, because moisture doesn't go over about, I'd say about 6 or 8 miles high, something like that. When we go overseas, we usually fly 19,000 feet, we're above the storm's end. But this cloud, according to this article here of this scientist, is 26 miles high. It would be miles and miles beyond moisture. And he said, checking the area, and now, you know, how many remembers that I told you it sounded like the sound breaker on a plane? Remember? But there was no plane in the district. The book says so here. They checked it. There were no planes up there. And besides, it couldn't, that fog behind a plane is nothing but broken up air, moisture, because it sucks through this unit as a jet. As it's pulling itself, it breaks the moisture in the air. They can never get rid of it as long as it's a jet, because it's got the, that's what it propels on. And it's the moisture scooting out from it. But here it is, miles above where there could be moisture, and no planes in the district. And it couldn't be moisture up there and hung up there that day. It's 30 miles across it, 26 miles high. You see, just as the same it was that picture there when I told you the angel of the Lord looked like a pillar of fire years ago before it was ever took. God! Make sound! Recognize!
Amen.
That is truth. And here, of the prophecy that was given, God make signs testify that it's the truth. Now, where do we stand? I want to keep this, for I may speak to a friend of mine that's present this morning to write those seven seals. He might want to use this for it. And so, you have a copy of it. Well, if you get one, hold it for reference. Now, he's wanting to find out, well, what good would he go tell him that? He'd laugh at it. He would just merely laugh. So don't test our pearls like that. But we know, the church knows, and God knows,
amen,
that it's the truth.
Amen.
And then while I was praying on this subject of wondering what would happen to me, and you know where I was at? north of Tucson, east of Flagstaff, just exactly positionally where I told you months before it happened to be standing, and exactly according to this paper here and the papers and this magazine and our own testimony, exactly where it's taking place. God is perfect and cannot lie. And it will come to pass. You remember on the tape, church, what time it is, I quoted over it. Remember, something's fixing to take place major. Now I made the whole nation testify to it. Every newspaper on the Associated Press and one of our leading magazines and everything else testified to it all over yet. But what a privileged people. A privileged people. It's Christian. To know that in this dark hour when there's no hope, according to science, there's an atomic bomb waiting for us. And no hope in our organizations ever getting together, they're consolidating with the mark of the beast. And when all of our hopes that way is gone in our economy of our Christian fellowship amongst the organizations, it's hiding up into Catholicism. Which will be a mark of the beast in the confederation of church. But in those who love God and are looking for reality, that the very God who made the promise in the Bible spreads it before our faith and makes the church and the people and science and magazines and everything recognize that He's still God and can build a promise. What a time. Then in Sabinia Canyon that morning, praying and wondering what would happen, holding my hands out to God up on top of that mountain, that sword dropped into my hand with a pearl handle and this guard over it and a long blade about 3 foot long and glistening like pot metal or like chrome, razor sharp. And I didn't know what it was. And I said, I'm afraid of these things. And just then a voice spoke that shook the canyon. Said, this is the sword of the Lord. And the sword of the Lord is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
For the word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword.
Amen.
Then coming back to that. Then during that time, a gallant little brother here in the church, and he was a soldier, got blown all to pieces in the army, almost laid out for dead, and said the medics didn't think he'd live and wasn't even worth fooling with. He was so far gone, the main nerves in his leg bursted, his little arm almost blown completely off, his leg, one leg off nearly. But God, seeing grace, saved him and healed him one day. Brother Roy Roberson's present when that picture was taken there at Houston. How his wife was told by a vision what she'd been doing today and how she had a trouble and would be healed. And that brought him a believer, but he, being a military man, was kind of a, I hope he forgives me for saying this, but more on the rough, precise side, giving orders in the army as a command of man. He had to sass out and do it. And he believed all. But standing and coming around with the church and seeing the supernatural, he said, I believe that, but that's for somebody else. One night, the Lord woke him up one morning. We were sitting, he and I, looked like in Jerusalem at the Lord's communion table. And I was talking, he couldn't understand it. And Brother Roy is sitting present, looking at me right now. And he saw it. And he called me up in Houston, out in Arizona, or sent me a letter, and I called him back. He said, you were sitting there, Brother Branham, and I saw that big pillar of light come in and get you and take you away from the Lord's table. And you went westward, because he was sitting on the east side watching me go west, and this light come in and take me out. So one morning, I had a vision. Got up in the bed about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, something like that, and saw this happen. And said his scream looked like for days, Brother Bill, come back! And Roy and I have been real brothers. We live together and hunt together, and we're just brothers. And he screamed for me until he was hoarse in his throat. Come back, bring him back, crying. said, here come that pillar of fire coming back, or cloud, come back. And he set me at the head of the table, and I've been changed. It was a mystery to Brother Roy. Me being changed, it looked different. I'll lay this up here for something I want to remember. Being changed when I give him the interpretation of it. That's just before I come back for the seven seals. When I come back for the seven seals, then one morning, he got a hold of Billy and he wanted to talk to me. And I was busy under prayer for the seven seals. And then he told me of it happened again, repeated again. Brother Roy, if I get this wrong, you call my attention. And he said he got up again in the morning, I guess early again in the morning. And there he looked in the room and he saw this big light or a cloud up on a mountain. He asked me, Uncle, was there something about a cloud being on a mountain? And I said, in the Bible? And I said, yes, when Peter, James, and John was tucked up in the cloud, overshadowed the Lord Jesus. And God spoke to this, my beloved son. I preached on that year not long ago, a little message. The tape, brother, might understand, hear ye him. I suppose maybe you have it on tape, I'm sure. And he said it. He went up the mountain, and when he did, I was standing there, and a voice came from the cloud, wasn't it, Brother Roy? And said, something on this order. This is my servant. And I've called him to be a prophet to the age, to lead the people, just as Moses did. And he's been given the authority, he could speak into existence. Something like that, like Moses did, like speaking into flies, and we know about the squirrels and so forth and things that's already took place. Little Hattie Wright back there is supposed to know what's taking place in her house. And he told him, but I had done what Moses had done. And he told me that coming down after a trip. And in my mind, I'd made up my mind that I was going to go up to Bud's because he's in a bad shape up there, the hunter. Before leaving here, I might drop this in. And we'll hurry. I dreamed a funny dream, an odd dream. And I hope when my brother-in-law gets hold of this, it doesn't hurt his feelings. I hope I don't hurt my wife, who's sitting present now. But she knows it about many months ago, right on, was around about October, November, I dreamed that I was a Roman out in the dark. And I had no place to go. And nobody cared for me. And I become a bum, just a bum. And I was cold. And I looked at a distance and I saw fire. And when I got over there, it was a city dump. And they had ditches, the fire was in these ditches, and between the ditches was slick where bums would sleep there to keep warm, keep from freezing between these fires on a cold winter night. And I was cold. And I walked up to this fire to get warm, and it was laying full of bums. And there were, I didn't see any of them, but they all like had stalls. There are places where their sleeping place was. And I saw my brother-in-law, Fletcher Broad. And Fletcher, how I remember him, he's a good kid. But this might be a lesson to the young children. I remember a few years ago, a handsome young man of James Fletcher Broad, and he got with the wrong crowd. And he took his first drink. I remember he called me behind the curtains in my house, and his daddy, that's gone on to glory years ago, was out there picking a guitar on the hills, far away stood an old rugged cross. And Fletcher called me back and said, Brother Bill, pray for me. Listen to that piece my daddy's playing, and I've been drinking today. I said, Fletcher, about 18-year-old boy, I said, don't go that route. But he never listened. He went on. He became a complete alcoholic. And his wife left him, his children. And he's just at this hour. And God knows I love him. I went to pray for him. Just a bum. I went to pray for him here not long ago. He got hurt.
while I was here at the Seven Seals. I said, Fletcher, I got a couple of suits up there I'd like to give you. He said, don't do it, Brother Bill. Now, I know he had no clothes. And I said, why don't you take the clothes? He said, uh-uh. And he looked up at me and said, you know what I do with them? Pawn them and get drunk. And I said, I'll give you a little money, Fletcher. He said, no, don't do it, Brother Bill. I don't want you to do it. He's a real guy at heart. But he's become an alcoholic and a bum. And his wife is took the wrong road. And all this, everything's happened to the poor fellow. And when I woke up, before I woke up, Fletch said to me, he said, in the dream, he said, Billy, I'll hunt you a place, Brother Bill. You fed my children when they were hungry. He said, you was a daddy to them. Now I'll find you a place sure to keep warm. And we went walking by the booms places and finally come to a place. He said, I'll sit down here. And I said, I'll walk up here and see if I can find a place. I walked up and looked out into the dark, cold night. Now, though, think of it. One time, God Almighty let me lead His church. One time He let me preach His gospel and see souls saved. Men and women come from around the world to speak with me for a few minutes. And here I am now, bum. Nobody wants me. And I'm cold. What must I do? And I woke up. I told my wife, I said, maybe it means that Fletch is in need, so we hurried up to see if we could find him. And his brother found him. He was staying out here with Widener's out there where they have trade horses and things, sleeping in the corner of a barn or something. I went on. I thought, well, just have to let it go. So I've come back down now from Canada with Fred and them the other day, and in my mind, I had it made up, if these people didn't want to hear my message, all right, they didn't have to. I've preached now for about 35 years. In the last 15, 18 years, I've done nothing but just the Lord have tried to live so close to Him and not say a word till He told me first. Everything, people say now, Brother Branham tells you He's coming. Remember, look out for a meeting because it's coming in the name of the Lord. You won't do nothing to the Lord, that's right. I waited till He told me. I didn't move till He told me. And then he got so for the last few months, he didn't tell me nothing about places to go. Then I come down from Canada, and Fred told, or Brother Roy told me his dream as he and I and Brother Banks rode along together just before we separated. And then the next day we got out to Brother Fred's, and his boy Lynn wasn't home, so he couldn't come on with us. Him and his wife had to wait. He picked up his wife there, Rosewood or Melrose, Saskatchewan. And Billy and I come on in Brother Fred's truck. That night we traveled most of the night, the next day. And then on the next morning, we had left Helena, Montana, and was coming on towards the border. And I can stay up till about 9 o'clock and I get sleepy. I got to sleep, and Billy, he wants to sleep till about 10 o'clock the next day when the daylight comes up, so it makes it pretty good for us to travel. So I got up about 4 o'clock and got started driving, and Billy was sleeping. We went into a place, and I was thinking on my mind, you know what? One of these days, as soon as I get the wife up there, now I won't tell her what I'm going to do, but I'll get up there, and I'm going to tell her I love this place so well, nobody of us going anywhere else, let's just stay here. And that's back from civilization, 1,100 miles from anywhere. See? Way in the world. I thought, well, won't that be fine? I won't have to get a haircut. Now, I won't have to dress up. And I'll just be a regular mountaineer. What I always wanted to be. And I said, I've got some guns and some people give me, and I'll be a guide like you never heard of. I'll just love it. And if the Lord tells me, go down and tell somebody something, I'll run out and tell them and come back again. And I'll help Bud, and we'll really have a real place here. I was thinking on that. We went into a restaurant to eat. A little place in the mountain, just about 7 o'clock. It was getting a little late. So I woke Billy up. We was out of gasoline, so had to get some gasoline and went into this little place, this little restaurant. And while there, a man come across the street, maybe a teeny bit older than I was, but he looked like a man to me. He had on a pair of overhaul jacket, riding boots, black hat, whiskers down on his face like this, snow white, hair hanging out from under his back of his hat. Oh, that looks like a man. Not some soft, lazy with a cigar in his mouth about that long, set with a pair of shorts on around some patio or swimming pool. Some pot-bellied Easterner. Well, excuse that expression. But hey, the guy looked like a man to me. Hard, rough. Looked like he lived where God made man to live. Now I was admiring him. He come into the restaurant and ordered some pancakes. There were about 15, 20 people. He had to sneeze. You know how some people pardon me. But he let out a great big healthy wood sneeze for chewing. It looked like the wind is blasting. When he did, nobody dared to say nothing. No, sir. I said, Billy, there's a man after my own heart. Oh, Daddy, you don't want to be like that. That's me in the future. I said, that's me. And I sat there a little bit. Billy looked up at me and kept on eating his pancakes. And I was finished mine. In a few minutes, somebody in a booth right around from us with a board this way, a back of the booth, I couldn't see around. A man got up that looked exactly my profile, about 75 years old. Little bitty fellow, his clothes tied on him, ragged. And the buddy that got up with him was Fletcher Broy, exactly. Gray hair hanging in his face. And Billy looked around and said, Daddy, that looks like you and Fletcher. You can imagine how I felt. And the little fellow looked like me, wobbled up. He'd been standing over a campfire. Smoke all over them, faces dirty. I think their breakfast together, a man must have paid 20 cents. Maybe a cup of coffee or something. My heart bounced within me. And I watched it. Billy said, what's the matter with you? I said, nothing. And I watched that. And they went around and went out. He said, Daddy, what's the matter? I said, nothing. And he got in the car. He said, do you mind driving in? I said, no. He said, I'm still sleeping. So he went to sleep. And I went speeding down the road about 55 miles an hour in the truck over the mountain, coming on towards the border, down to coming home to Arizona, but I was coming now into Utah. And as I got there, coming down through the mountains about 20 miles out of the city, just as if you've heard it, as I told you about the morning, about the squirrels and all these things, how something, somebody went to talking to me. A voice just the same as you hear mine. I know it sounds neurotically, but as I've got to expressing, have I ever told you anything but what was right? And a voice got to talking. I was talking to him. It said, carry out your plans and you'll be like that. I said, Lord, I don't want to be like that. Said, your wife will go too. She won't live up there in the hills like that. And you'll become a bum. Just as the dream showed you would. I said, I don't want to be that. But I don't want to have to live like that. I want to do something different. But I was told that you'd call me to be a prophet. And I want to live in the wilderness like the prophet. But I was using my own excuse so I could hunt. My own good. And he said, but that was the prophets of the Old Testament. You've been called to be that in a much higher office than that. He said, you have more gifts besides that. You was called to pray for the sick and to preach the gospel and the apostolic forms, you know, of greater things, many great gifts. He said, why do you wait for me to move you every time you move? Where is your reward? Then I seen. And then said, do you remember? I told you, yes, yes. Do you remember what Brother Roberson told you? In your dream, in his dream, or vision, Now you had done like Moses. You forgot the feeling of your people. You forgot the call that I called you to. I let the sick lay. I want Lord to tell me where to go and not to. That's wrong. I built myself a complex because the people didn't hear my message. And if you, and God forbid that I try to compare the life of now like Moses, but it's exactly what Moses did. The people wouldn't listen to him when he come to deliver him, so he just left them alone. He went into the wilderness, but God turned him around. And he long forgot the suffering people. And then I said, Lord, if how could I, that's right, with no education, with a grammar school education, be able, and the people stand in rows and everywhere to hear the simple gospel? It's more, it's greater now than it was under the old covenant. He ascended on high and gives gifts unto man. See? Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Hallelujah.
Then I was talking, and I heard it talking to me, and it left me, and I said, Billy? And he was sound asleep. I said, Billy, was that you? And he didn't even wake up. And I thought, Lord God, I slowed my car down. What does this mean? And I said, Billy? Billy? I said, what do you want? And I said, you talking to me? No. Why? And I said, I want to tell you something. I dreamed a dream not long ago. You remember seeing that guy look like me in flesh? Ask Mother when he gets back to Tucson. I told her this dream. And, Billy, something happened. It's going on now. Something was talking to me, and I thought it was you. He looked at me kind of strange and waited a little bit. We're driving on. So a few minutes, he went back to sleep again. And I was driving along thinking about what could that mean? Driving along right on the road, and all at once, here come talking again. And he said, return. Did not I tell you in the beginning to do the work of an evangelist? When I called you down the river, did not I say that John the Baptist was sent forth to forerun the first coming? Wasn't John more than a prophet?
Amen.
Jesus said so himself. What'd you go out to see a prophet? Said more than a prophet.
Amen.
Then it all began to come to me. I began to wonder. Then he reminded me again of the people. How, doing what Moses did, how could Moses reach the people in the wilderness? Well, how could I reach the people in the wilderness? Exactly the same thing. Then it comes, this 2 Timothy 4. We remember when we dedicated the church that morning 30 years ago, some of you old-timers, when he showed me them trees and I planted them on both sides. You remember that? You remember the vision? It's all wrote in books and on tapes and everything. And years ago, how I seen these, and I never crossed up the oneness in the Trinity. I stood between them and planted these trees, and they were the only two trees that had fruit. Now, all the trees grew up about 30 feet and stopped. These went plumb into heaven. Broke off of the same branch. See? One on one side, one on the other, and I broke them. You remember the vision. See? Wrote the books and sent my life story and all. And they went plumb up into heaven like that quickly. And he said, hold out your hands for the fruit. And then I found the same fruit in the cross when I run down there, and he said, do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of your ministry. The time will come when they have not endured sound doctrine. Don't quit then. Keep going. That all come into my mind. And then I remember this Marilyn Monroe, the girl that I saw die about a week before she died, and how that they said she committed suicide when she didn't. I told him about it before, what would happen, and it did like it did the boxers up there and wanted to go to kill the others. I'm mistaken the girl. There's another girl. There, her cousin is Danny Henry. What is her name? Jane Russell. Her cousin, a Baptist boy. And I was preaching in Los Angeles at the businessman's breakfast,
and standing there just laying down on those organizations. And that's that the head man of the assemblies and many of the great dignitaries gathered in there. And when I got through the speaking and started to leave the platform getting ready, because the message was being sent out across the nation on radio, and I had to change back. During this change, when they cut off the radio, then to send that message out and come back and announce the station, and I was at Clifton, where we had the breakfast, and as I was walking from the upper platform to the lower, a fine, handsome-looking young fellow of about 30 years old run forth and threw his arms around me. He said, "I'm Danny Henry." And not knowing that was his brother doing the televising. And it televises there for the Christian Businessman. And it's Jane Russell, that movie star, her cousin. Her mother's a Pentecostal preacher. And then when he started running to me, and he threw his arms around me and said, "God bless you, Brother Branham." He said, "I hope this don't sound sacrilegious, but to my way of seeing it, that message could be the 23rd chapter of Revelation." And when he said that, he started speaking in tongues. A boy who never even heard of such a thing. A Baptist by denomination. And as soon as he turned white, and he looked at me, and he didn't know what to do. There's a man sitting here was there. When you left, Fred, how many was there at that time?
Yeah,
there's three here. Was there at that time. And he didn't know what to say. And there's a great big French woman sitting down here. She raised up, she said, "Why, that don't need any interpretation. That was purely French." The boy said, "I don't know one word of French." And she wrote down what he said. And then there's a man sitting on the corner. He said, "That's correct. I've got to wrote down what he said is French." Way back in the back, a blonde-headed, handsome-looking fellow stand up against the wall, come forward to compare notes. He was the interpreter for the UN for French. And this man over here was Victor Leduc of the Arnivik Church out there. And he wrote it down, and I've got the interpretation to it. Listen to this. If I could read it. "I, Victor Leduc, am a full-blooded Frenchman, born-again Christian, filled with the Holy Spirit. My address is 809 North King Road, Los Angeles 46. I attend the Bethel Temple, Pastor Arne Vick Pastor. A true translation that I proclaim of prophecy said over Brother Branham, given by Danny Henry in French, February the 11th, 1961, at the Full Gospel Businessman's Breakfast. A true translation of the prophecy." Now here's what it says. "Because thou hast chosen the narrow path, the harder way, thou hast walked in your own choosing." Now I can see that Moses had to make his choice too. "Thou hast picked the precise and correct way, correct decision, and it is my way." Underline. My way. The Holy Spirit speaking back. "Because of this momentous decision, a huge portion of heaven awaits you, awaits thee. What a glorious decision, now listen close, what a glorious decision thou hast made. This in itself is that which will make and come to pass a tremendous victory in the love divine." You notice, it's the verb before the adverb. See? In French. Now the UN interpreter interpret that, and the boy knows not one word. Never heard such thing as speaking in tongues. It's a Baptist. Just happened to drop in there, hear that music, and said, "Come up there and stand up there and listen to me preach." Now, in the love divine, divine love. How can that be divine love if it isn't the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is divine love. Now, and as Billy and I started on down the road, see, started going on down the road, Billy went to sleep again, and it said, "I'll give you an everlasting sign." I said, "Lord, what?" I waited a little bit, nothing happened. I said, "What is the everlasting sign, Lord?" And I waited a few minutes, and just then, I looked over to see Billy, he was asleep. And he said, "I'll give you an everlasting sign."
again. He said, look westward from where you're at. And I turned my head like this in a truck to look, slowed down real, and oh my, the Spirit of the Lord, I felt like I could scream and cry. I looked, and I just saw a mountain with white caps on it. I said, I don't know. See no everlasting sign about that. He said, your name is wrote all over it. Well, I thought, what is that? And I got real weak, and I started stopping. And Billy raised up and said, what's the matter with you? And I was holding my hands like this, perspiration dropping off my hand, that snowing. I said, Billy, something's happening. At one time, I know what I've done wrong. I know that I failed God. And look like I could hear that song being sung and see thousands of mixed people, lame, halt, blind, and withered, hear a choir, a voice of some great renowned voice singing, unclean, unclean, the evil spirits drove him. You know the song, then Jesus came and set the captive free. I could see the sick lines laying everywhere. And I had to stop. Billy didn't know what was taking place. And I looked up, I stopped and looked up on the mountain. And I seen those seven hills. Now here, if you want to see something. There were seven peaks on top of a mountain, one mountain, that run for several miles. The last mountain before you go into the other country. No more mountains after that. And it was running from east to the west, the mountain set. And it was snow-capped on top. The first two small peaks, and then a large peak. And then another small peak, and then a larger peak. And then a small peak, and then a great, large, long, snow-capped mountain. And I said, Lord, I do not understand what that means. He said, how many peaks are there? I said, there's seven. How many letters is in your name? B-R-A-N-H-A-M. M-A-R-R-I-O-N. B-R-A-N-H-A-M. And there were three outstanding peaks. He said, those three peaks are the first, second, and third pull. The first one was your first part of your ministry. Small hill. Then your first pull, pretty high, you know, sign of hand. Then there was a little interview in there, the time that I was taken off from being too tired, many of you remember. And then come the discernment, the second pull. Now, I've had another about few years here of just kind of a little peace. See, back like my ministry was. And then come the third one. Three is a number of completion. See, the third one. The next peak was five, number of grace. And the next peak was seven, a number of perfection, the end. 6 days shall you labor, the seventh is the Sabbath, the end of the week, the end of time.
Amen.
And I stopped and I showed it to Billy. And I looked at that and he said, that stand, if there's ever a doubt in your mind, remember this place, come back here. And Billy punched me on the shoulder and said, Daddy, look eastward. And how it ever happened, I don't know, but there on the east side of the road was that burning dump. Miles and miles from any kind of a city, an old rubbish heap dump laying on the left-hand side of the road. I'm returning to the field. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Old or young, live or die. All will be God. Until death shall set me free. I have failed
the law.
Not willing. Whether I may, I've tried. Let me insert this. More tape left. Let me insert this. I've wanted to see Jesus Christ manifested without one flaw. And let the brethren who hear this tape in this church remember from this day, the reason you haven't had no flaws, and the reason of all these years you can't say one thing it ever said or done but what it happened. I challenge anybody to bring any of the thousands of things on the platform and the discernment and the prediction of what would happen. It's happened exactly to the letter. Now the church believes that, say amen for it.
Amen.
There's not a person in the world can show one. But be it known to the church here and to the church hereafter, if God pushes a man through a pipe and he don't move at all until God tells him there's no faith connected with it, it's God pushing you to something, and it's built the ministry to a place to where there's nobody can say one word against it. But from henceforth, let me first speak to you in the name of the Lord before you listen, because I must go out by faith. I must do it by faith, whether I think it's right or wrong or what, I do the best of my choosing and then go do it. Because it hasn't been wrong, it's because I've waited till He told me to go do it. I've waited for Him, so it wasn't me, it was Him. But you see, even the great St. Paul got between the straits one time. And many times that God has did things, or let His servants do it, that was mistaken, in order to prove these things. Now, we know that human beings can make mistakes, but God can make no mistakes. But now, if I get into the field of preaching and going the way I do, then I have to set up meetings ahead and get things lined up, and perhaps this is that great time coming that we've been looking for.
Hallelujah.
And surely, if this in itself is a tremendous thing that will bring to pass and make from the pass the tremendous victory in the love divine, and that's the verb before adverb, that is divine love, which is God. See? And then it takes the love of God to dash out there on the front line and stand in the gap for the people. And these Rickies and Rickettas, so fast the words that I've called them Ricky and Ricketta, God gives me to understand I shouldn't do that, because that many of them are still His children. They can't help because they act so much different. Some of these old cold formal churches has got them, that spirit up on them. And they're as much in prison as Israel was in prison. Just as much as Moses went out to deliver them from slavery. Human beings that love Jesus Christ would serve Him if they only know what to serve Him by.
Amen.
And they're in bondage under denominationalism that tells them, don't you do this and don't you do that. But the call of God must come. Whoever wants to march towards the promised land, let him march.
Hallelujah.
We're on our road to the promised land. Amen. Let them come march. We're on our road to meet Christ at the end of time. And I wanted to bring this to you so that you would see and show you that the mistake that a man can make yet being sincere. Moses lost the feeling of his people.
Hallelujah.
Because they wouldn't listen to him. And Brother Roy, you see your dream? And now, I cannot go with a ministry like that until I feel different in my heart about it. No matter if God did tell me. But that is a change that Brother Roy is coming. Something's got to change me. Because in my heart, if I go out there feeling the way I do now, I still feel that they are to hear that message, you are to do it. And I don't have the feeling for the people that I should have. Until I can get that feeling, it's only in me gone because I'd be a hypocrite. And all these years I've tried to serve Him with a true heart. And I won't go out there being a hypocrite. I got to feel that it isn't Ricky and Ricketta. And it isn't this bunch. It's God's children that's in bondage and I must go to. And until I can feel that way, I'll just have to loaf around. Preach some conventions and things. But wait. I got a little song. I can't sing. I would just like to quote it to you. heard it, and I just kind of mapped out. I ain't got it filled out. It ain't wrote right. I don't know where I could even read it or not. It's in the tune of the battle hymn of Republic. Glory, glory, hallelujah. You've heard it. Glory, glory, hallelujah. How many? Of course, we all heard that.
Yeah.
The circuit rider preacher went riding through the land with a rifle on his shoulder and a Bible in his hand. He told the prairie people of the blessed promised land as he went riding, singing along, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning on the everlasting arms. He preached a coming judgment, a fire and brimstone, and a glorious, endless heaven of the justified alone. As he rode across the mountain, you could hear him sing this song. As he went riding on, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, oh wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. The old circuit preacher, you remember him? See? Now his rifle's old and rusty. And it's hanging on the wall. His Bible, very worn and dusty, and he seldom touched it all. That's right. But the message that it brings us will meet us on that day, for God's truth still marching on. All glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. We'll learn that. I stood this morning when I was writing that down, put my hand on the whole gospel, hang on the wall, so it won't be long.
Hallelujah.
Bible's old and rusty as it's hanging on the wall. That's right. And the Bible's worn and dusty and is seldom touched at all. But his message from this Bible is his judgment one day, and his truth keeps marching on. God's truth of this Bible.
Hallelujah.
Yeah? Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The old circuit preacher with his rifle across his back, his Bible in his hand, rode across the prairies, before the mountains, down to the ditches and everywhere, preaching of a coming millennium.
Hallelujah.
Of a coming fiery judgment for the unjust, and preaching a kingdom of God for the just.
Hallelujah.
It's true. The old Winchesters are rusting away. And the Bible, they've got some sex book instead of it. But God's truth still marches on. He makes itself just as real today and proves it as he ever was. God's truth keeps marching on.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
For Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let's sing it again.
Now we're mixed up here, Methodist, Baptist, Luther, and everything else. While we sing that last chorus, let's shake hands with somebody around you, and then we'll be dismissed. And now remember, you that has to go to your own church, go tonight, greet your pastor for me, and then pray for me, each one of you. And then again, I want you to remember, if you have no place to go, if you got anything, after Brother Neville's message tonight, after he has his message, then I want to make a tape called The Red Flashing Light of His Coming, see, tonight. The Lord bless you now, and next week, next Sunday, the Lord's willing, I may be down again to make another tape, because I'll have to be in Arkansas this next week. Amen. All right. Now let's sing again and shake hands out.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Lord Jesus, let's be thankful.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Now, let us bow our heads just a moment. You're just in time, Brother Ruddle. Walk up here just a minute. Brother Ruddle, another one of our associate brethren here, of a little association of churches we have together, this interdenominational. And I've heard the gallant stand that Brother Ruddle's taken for the gospel.
Amen.
Amen.
And so I say this, Brother Ruddle, that everything along the road, God has not promised a flowery bed of ease. But He promised a battle. Yes, but He promised victory.
Amen.
That's the thing. I remember when I first took this stand, even my own mother and father wanted to turn me from the house.
Hallelujah.
I don't know how I baptized them in the name of the Lord Jesus. The only hopes I ever have today is because of the stand. I'm so glad. That's a message of the Bible from the old circuit preacher down to this time. Though people have got a hold of it, and they've trimmed it around, and they've made denominations and put creeds and everything else in it, that truth still marches on.
Amen.
Right? It still marches on. God bless you, each one, and we hope to see you again real soon. Until then, will you do this one favor for me now, both here and on tapes also, dear brother? Pray that God will place into my heart that something that I lost out there in that complex.
Amen.
It's so easy to build a complex. I had an interview the other day with my brother Wade sitting here. Sitting here, brother. A good man, but built himself around a complex. Another kind of a complex. Did the same thing. Brother Wade, you can so easily do it. You just get a little something in your mind. Keep thinking that way. Go back and check it with the Scripture, see if it's right or not. And then go from there. Yes. Don't lose the feeling of the people. And you must remember, they're not made out of sawdust. They're of flesh and blood. Human beings of the soul. Pray for me, all of you, if you will. God bless you now. We're going to bow our heads and ask Brother Ruddle if he'll walk. Okay, brother.
And to show you that it was real, I was telling Brother Wood, when you go by out in the station wagon this morning, the night before last, I had a dream. I dreamt that you had a rod with you as with Moses. But I dreamt that you had laid that rod down for some purpose. And that rod was restored to you because it pleased God for you to use that rod. And as the Spirit of God is upon me this morning, I'll say by the Spirit, thus saith the Lord, that the Lord God shall be with thee, and shall go with thee, and you shall perform the word that he spoke to you.
Praise be to God. This is a minister. Somebody might not know. And he was one of the group that didn't have time this morning. It was in one of those dreams speaking of me going the other way. See, going west, going out west on this last time. Brother J.T. Parnell. Now, there might be strangers that wonder about people having dreams. Of dreamers. No, we don't go for all kinds of dreams. But we believe that the Bible said, and it shall come to pass in the last days. Now I'll pour out my spirit upon the people, and they shall prophesy, and shall see visions, and dream dreams. And as long as that's in the lids of the Bible, it's my duty to believe it and to preach it. And when people tell dreams, if the Lord doesn't give the interpretation, we let it go. And if it's something, when anyone speaks with tongues, it must be something to the church that must happen too. We don't it'd be an evil spirit. It must come to pass. Because interpretation of tongues is prophecy. We know that's right. So we try here to live the Bible just the way it's taught. Take nothing away from it or add nothing to it, but just live it the way it is. The Lord be blessed. That helps me, Brother J.T., to believe that God didn't tell me to go out now and compromise the sin, but just go out and just keep on doing it. Let us pray now, Brother. Someone fainted. Just a minute. Sit still. Heavenly Father, let thy righteousness be the way of
God. Amen.
That Lord, so help me, this heart starts speaking.
Hallelujah.
It's over. As I stand here on this altar where funerals have been preached, where I stand here where hundreds of people have prayed to the Christ, I reach down his eyes and set his pulse was gone, and no more than call the name of Jesus Christ and his pulse starts
going. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
As a minister of the cross, I say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Isn't he wonderful? A heart attack. See? I'm so thankful it happened just now instead of waiting until we got away. See the grace of God?
Amen.
The Lord be blessed. Let us just bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you now for your goodness and your mercy. You're ever in our midst. Give me, Lord, oil in my lamp. Give me the rod of the Lord that I might stretch it out up over the sick and afflicted. That I might bring it out upon to bring deliverance to those who are needy and judgment to those who are rejecting. Grant it, Father. We thank you for all your goodness in the name of Jesus Christ.
Brother Ruddle?